welcome everyone to our forum on sexuality and breast cancer. We're really excited to have this wonderful panel here to talk about some of the different things that women might be experiencing after having a mastectomy, and also we know that some of the drugs that people have with chemotherapy also can impact their sexual function. So we're really excited to have this wonderful panel of experts to talk about that. We have probably, always a ton of people on Facebook Live, so we're welcoming them as well. If you have any questions and you don't feel comfortable standing up and asking them, you can wave down one of the social workers, raise your hands, and we can take a little note and ask them for you. And if people want to ask questions on Facebook Live, you can put that in the comments as well. So without further ado, I'm going to bring up Lori to begin our program. Come on up.
Hello. It's nice to be here to be with all of you. Breast cancer has affected my family life personally, and I'm also a Adelphi graduate, 2005 with my social work degree. And my mother actually retired after 42 years of service in this very room probably a few months ago. So if my mom's watching, hello. So we are here from NYU Winthrop, the Behavioral Health Department. We're very happy to be here. We are going to be presenting on body image and sexuality after breast cancer. So just a little bit about what we're going to be discussing. We're going to start with historical perspectives, move on to biological aspects, and then talk about psychodynamics. So I get to do the fun part and show you pictures of breasts throughout history. So, starting in 27,000 BC, we can see that breasts were very important and really translated into fertility. The pretty famous statue, the Venus of Willendorf, showing very large breasts and a very large body, it was very important in terms of fertility. Then we move on to the ancient Egyptians, who enjoyed nakedness, but did not put much of the breast on their statues in their art. They are depicted as almost no breast at all, even though erotic art was very important at that time. Sorry for the mix up. But then Hellenistic Greek, we have statues and art that are very much in proportion. Breasts are they're almost pretty small. They're almost, it's almost male-like, their bodies. And then moving on to ancient Roman, big breasts were very attractive, even though they can be too big, and in those cases, they were mocked. They didn't like them to be too big, but big enough. Roman breasts were perky and didn't need any support. So we know how realistic that is, right? And then we come to 9th to 13th century India. These breasts were almost like they were floating on air. They were very pointy, almost spherical in shape. And the interesting thing about this history is to show that even in different parts of the world, in different centuries, as time went on, breasts were extremely important in every part of society, whether or not they were seen to be very large, very small, realistic or not realistic. Then we hop on over to the Middle Ages, where breasts were considered to be sinful. It was a time of modesty, very religious time. Breasts were very minimal, and they were seen as something to be fixed if they were too big. And then we come to Japan, which is the exact opposite, even though it's right around the same time. Breasts were very large. They sagged slightly. Pure white skin, which was very important in Japanese culture, they were considered to be the higher end of nobility, with very small nipples. 16th century Europe came the fleshy ladies, which I'm sure they did not like being called, but that's okay. So these breasts were, the body became a little bit bigger, but the breasts were still considered to be pretty small and humble. 19th century France, which was maybe the beginning of the first realistic picture of the breasts. They were small, slightly threading shape, with pronounced nipples. Victorian England, they were seen to have just a small swell on top, very cinched waist, and anything more than that was vulgar. So now we come to America, where the Gibson girls were very important in the 20th century. These breasts were very pronounced. They liked to show their breasts, maybe a little bit of heaving over the top, and again, very small waist. So we see over time that, again, some of these aspects stay the same and then some of them change. And then the flappers came around, and all the Gibson girls were probably very upset because they did not have the flapper shape. The flapper shape is washboard, flat, breast, very thin. And then as my grandmother was probably horrified to see the maiden form bra in the ads of magazines and newspapers. This was a time that all of a sudden breasts were given the attention to actually have some shape. And they guess they really rigged them up with the bras, but it's a lot different than just 10 years before when the flappers were around. And then Twiggy came around, and she was very thin. This was now considered sexy, very thin, flat-chested, no bras, so breasts were a little saggy. And the body was also very thin. And then Pamela Anderson came, which was very different than Twiggy. So all of a sudden we have these beach blonde women running down beaches, breast implants, very thin waist, a very often unattainable for the average woman. And then the 90s were a little bit different. In the 90s we had Cindy Crawford, Naomi Campbell, the supermodel age, and they all had big breasts, but also Kate Moss made her career based on being really thin and no breast at all. And I'm sorry, but I had to use Kim Kardashian for our time. Big breasts are back. And I thought it was really interesting that it says that Kim Kardashian's breasts get more column inches than global warming. So now we're back into a time where breasts are really important. So it has been seen over time that breasts have always been in the forefront for women, no matter what time, no matter what area you lived in, and it seems like it continues to be. So I'm going to conclude my part and hand it over to Dr. Karen Pappas to talk about biology.
Thank you, Lori. It's wonderful to be here with everybody. So now that we've reviewed some of the historical perspective to sexuality, I want to sort of drill down and kind of discuss definition of sexuality, discuss a lot of the different layers and complexity that goes into sort of understanding the various components of sexuality. But before I begin that and discuss some of the definition, I'm curious to sort of ask the audience about what they think or how would they define sexuality from their perspective. Anybody want to venture a comment? No? Oh,
please. It could be how someone feels or perceives themselves as a female, as a male, you know, one's identity.
Right, absolutely. Right, and look, it's a very complex sort of topic. Go ahead. Yeah.
I think also maybe myself and other people get a little confused between sexuality and sensuality.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
Maybe talk a little bit about the differences.
Absolutely, absolutely. And anybody else? No. Okay. So you're absolutely right. I think both of you sort of touched upon sexuality and a lot of these layers that I'm going to be talking about, and helps to try to define sexuality, because it's really not an easy thing to sort of pin down. Okay? So sexuality. in the most general basic terms, it's how one goes about the entire experience of how one expresses himself as a sexual being, right? So the degree one chooses to express their sexuality, the way that one goes on to show to express their sexuality, and with whom they decide to express that sexuality with, partner-wise, is a very individual experience, right? Very much like we select our clothing and our sense of style, it's very individualistic. Sexuality, in some ways, is very individualistic as well. It's a very rich and complex human experience. And it's really difficult, if you look up sexuality, it's not always easy to sort of pin it down as a term. So the components, here's just various components to help understand sexuality. One being the sensuality, one that you touched upon. And that's sort of like the physical components that we think about. The touching, the feeling, the actual act of sex is more captured in that sense. But sexuality is more than just the physical component, right? And intimacy and relationship is another important component. And that's more than just the physical component. It also, it's the emotional component, how one feels in the relationship that they're in, right? The actual relationship and the dynamics of the relationship, right, is a component of sexuality. The other is gender, how one expresses their gender and who they identify as is another component of sexuality. And the final component is sexual health. And that usually entails maintaining sexual health, you know, using contraceptives when appropriate, you know, and maintaining, you know, good physical health, checkups, things like that, right? So, but those four components also interact with many other things, right? Because it's a complex term, interacts with culture, experience, or spirituality. So there's a lot of interaction from these various components and society at large, right? And our beliefs and culture. So I know this is a complex sort of diagram, but it really captures how complex the concept of sexuality is, right? And what I want to show here is what you guys see here in the mustard-colored arrows. These arrows represent innate components of sexuality, meaning we're born that with those components. It's very hard to change, right? So our genes, it's just our genetic makeup, right? Pheromones, which are involved in attraction, right? Our hormones and physiology, and I'll touch upon some of those hormones and how they sort of impact sexuality and their importance in sexuality. The other is these erotic rewards and reward system. And what I'm going to show you shortly is neurotransmitter chemicals that actually are important in the process of reward, right? And actually have an importance in how certain behaviors and certain experiences are etched in our brain, or how we remember things and things of that type. And the green here is the emotion and cognition. Now that's not innate. That's things that we acquire, right? That's an acquire is as the way that we're raised and things in our families, culture all around. So those are influence. And then of course we have the environment, right? And how you sort of integrate and package those things together is very individualized in how it's learned and how you will then go on to express your sexuality or your desires, okay? So there's so many different factors that go in to express contribute to one's sexuality. And I'll refer back to this slide, but the next thing I want to discuss is, as we tease out sexuality further, is to look at the physiological approach, then we'll look at the psychosocial approach, and how those two also contribute to helping us understand sexuality. So from a physiological approach, we have at first puberty starts, we have pubic hairs forming at age 8, at age 9, girls will then start the breast development period, And there's also psychological factors that I'm going to impress upon you that also go along with this period, followed by menarche, when women first have their period. And, you know, one thing I constantly hear is, you know, that's when they come into their womanhood, or at least that's how families sort of express that to young girls when they first get their period. So it's a very monumental moment for some families and for girls. And followed by puberty, completing itself around 18, okay? And then fertility will then peak itself in the mid to late 20s, and by age 50, it sort of then tipped out. And that brings us to a different physiological point in a female's journey. Okay. So that's the physiology behind sexuality, or contributes to it. But I want this, how many people are familiar with Ericksonian stages? Yeah, okay, great, okay. So, Erikson had developed several stages, but I really want to just focus on the ones that really tie into sexuality with great importance, at least in this talk, is to look at age 13 to 21, which refers to identity versus role confusion. So as I was telling you, menarche begins, but during this time, women and men, or males, are trying to determine their own identity, its exploration. The whole concept of brain body image comes to of greater importance. So this is a time of exploration, right? So, and this is followed by the next stage of intimacy and exploration relationships, right? So that's another important stage. And people can get stuck in these various stages and can impact their social and psychological development. So knowing these things will tie in with some of the things that Phil and Jerry was sort of mentioned, but I just wanted to give you both a biological and a psychosocial construct that we help ourselves and patients to sort of figure out how to think about sexuality and how it impacts that.
Okay.
Unfortunately, this slide didn't come up that well, but it sort of refers to some of the biology that goes in for love, right? And there's hormones and there's neurotransmitters that actually impact various things, such as attraction. You know, for many would sort of think of testosterone as being one of those hormones that contribute to such things. The other one being attachment, oxytocin is one of those hormones that we think of that contribute to that, and some of the neurotransmitters that I'm going to be talking about shortly. But as you can see, it's also, love is a very complex process biologically and chemically as well. Okay, so dopamine. Has everybody heard of dopamine? Okay, so dopamine is really important. It's found in our brain. It's really important from a sexuality standpoint because it keeps us very focused, right? It helps and it contributes to focus on our partners, right? So it helps in that sense. But it also helps in maintaining dependency, right? Because it keeps us sort of focused and maintains that healthy attraction. So dopamine is a neurotransmitter that's critical in those processes. The other one is norepinephrine. So norepinephrine, you might hear, is causing that rush, exhilaration with being with a new person or being with somebody over time. It also enhances our memory capacity, right? So what you'll find is norepinephrine actually makes us remember many of the important little details of our partners, right? So norepinephrine really has a intricate part in that those little details that we remember of our partners. Serotonin. I found this image with the sun because I think it's very appropriate. But serotonin is released after climax. It's what sort of contributes to some of that calmness that one feels. It brings the deep feelings of calmness and satisfaction and sort of that stress relief. So it's also another neurotransmitter of importance. If testosterone, known that is a hormone, it's one of the hormones that associated with desire, both in males and females, but a little bit more in males. And oxytocin. Oxytocin is also one that's released during that climax and contributes to some of that calmness. But oxytocin is also important. When we were talking about sexuality, we were talking about the intimacy, relationships. Actually, oxytocin is released when we give hugs and the cuddling and the intimacy in that way, emotional. So it also gets released in the brain, is of great importance. But I also wanted to end my section here with introducing the erogenous zones. Although Lori told us all about the breast and the breast throughout history, it's really important to keep in mind the erogenous zones are more than just the breasts, okay? We actually have 10 different erogenous zones that contribute to our sexuality and our pleasure zone. So it's important to keep in mind that breasts are not the only erogenous zone. We have mouth, lips, back, neck, nipples, lower back, vagina, breast, ears, nape of the neck, clitoris, and the inner thigh. Okay, so so I just want to impress upon you that the breast is not the only important feature, but there's actually many more. And at that note, I'll introduce Dr. Phil and Jerry. We'll talk about some of the psychological dynamics.
Good evening, and thank you for having us here. I'm Dr. Carol Filangeri, and I am a clinical neuropsychologist at Winthrop's Department of Behavioral Health. And I'm pleased to be here and talk to you guys a little bit about the psychological aspects of gender and sexuality. This will get me all night. I'm left-handed, so I'm always backwards to begin with, and this thing's backwards to me. Anyway, as Dr. Karen Patz has mentioned earlier, he talked about the physiological and the social aspects of gender, and I'd like to talk a little bit about the psychological aspects. And, you know, for many of us, our gender identity begins before we're born. It really begins when our parents, through a sonogram or through amniotic testing, find out that they're having a girl or a boy, and everything moves from that point. The names, they start to talk to the baby in the womb. They name the baby. The nursery gets loaded with pink if they're having a girl, and blue if they're having a boy, and they're going to buy frilly clothes for girls with, with flowers and with butterflies, and the boys are going to get the non-frilly clothes that have trucks on them or sports insignias. But it really starts early. It starts before we're even aware that we're human. And it continues throughout our lives, and it continues right through all of Ericksonian's stages. We're always kind of in the forefront thinking about our gender, and it's just always there. And what I wanted to talk a little bit about is how it starts to form. As I said, it starts to form before we're born, and then it's reinforced as we're infants, and how people interact with us. Oh, girls are so cute, and boys are, they're real strong and tough. But so it isn't until we're about 2 to 3 years old, when we start to have language, that we really identify ourselves as our gender. And it isn't until we're about 4 or 5 where we realize that, oh, if I'm a girl, I'm always a girl, and if my best friend's a boy, he's always a boy. And it isn't until 6 or 7 where we develop gender constancy, where we can discern that if a girl has short hair, that's still a girl, or if a boy has long hair, that's still a boy. And that's really the psychological components of gender. And as I said, they continue through our lives. There's a lot of pressure as we're growing up and being teenagers, and as Dr. Karen Patz has said about identity, confusion, and as he talked about the stage, where we're trying on different identities, we're still conforming to what it means usually to be a boy or a girl, and we do this, and these roles just get reinforced through our lives. And as, I'll do this right, as Lori showed us, breasts and breast size has been objectified for at least 27,000 years. At least. It's probably been objectified since women have had breasts. And there's no analogy to male, to the way a male is depicted. Men, we don't see 27,000 years of different penis sizes, right? Men are always kind of depicted the same way. But for women, we have this objectification of the breast as being central to our femininity, right? It's always there. You know, we have this time. It's so exciting when we're first, or it's frightening when we're first developing breasts and we have to go and get a bra. And it's this, you know, this big secret thing of going to the lingerie department and getting measured. It's a rite of passage. You know, boys, they get underwear. And it continues with our period, and you know, there's just the sacredness to it and the symbolism to having breasts and how important they are. And for many women, when they have to have a mastectomy, or they have to have a lumpectomy, or they have to have any kind of surgery that changes that shape or changes the symmetry, it causes a rupture. It causes a rupture in what it means to be a woman. And it's a very difficult time. And there was a study, and this study was a recent one. It was done a couple of years ago, last year. And, you know, it was a large study where they asked women, breast cancer survivors, who'd had surgery, to discuss what it felt like. And they used terms like that they were wretched, that the surgery area was wretched, it was horrible, it was scary, it was ugly. These women were talking about their bodies. And think about that. Think about those awful words that they were using to describe their bodies and how that affects their self-identity and their sexuality. It's I don't want to diminish how difficult it is to make these choices and to have to go through the treatment. But when you're using the same terms, these horrible terms, on yourself, you're really, really hurting yourself. They really hurt themselves. And really, the choices that they had were life or death choices, and they chose life, which is the ultimate great thing. So what can we do about it? One thing that we do know is that women are less likely to talk to their providers about these issues, about issues of sexuality, of how they're feeling, when they feel that their providers are rushed, are kind of cursory, or they don't have enough privacy to talk about it. So I mean, it's not, I don't think that the onus is on the breast cancer patient, but it's on me, it's on us as a healthcare providing field to really make a space for a woman who's going through treatment to talk about these things and to make sure that she, if she's comfortable and wants to talk about these things, she can. So it's so important for me and my profession healthcare providers to listen. So that's one big piece of communication. But But the other piece of communication is talking to our partners, our significant others, the people in our lives who share intimacy with us. You know, and sometimes that includes hearing from them that it's okay, that they still care about us and love us for who we are. We're not just this objectified body, but we're so much more. And with the treatments that we have, recognizing that, you know, sexuality will change, that maybe it's not so comfortable to have sex. Maybe you're just not feeling comfortable being touched or feeling good or feeling energy, feeling like you have enough energy. But there are other things that can create intimacy and talking and other ways in which to approach sex, like what Dr. Karen Patz has said, you know, stimulating other erogenous zones can be helpful. But it's important to also, if you have a great relationship with your partner, to really have them come and be with you through the decision-making process so that you don't feel alone. And then some more practical things to help cope with sexuality after breast cancer include exercise. I mean, we talk about exercise for everything. It's great for depression, it's great for anxiety. Any kind of exercise that gets your body moving is going to release endorphins. And we know endorphins are these feel-good chemicals. They make us feel better about ourselves. So it's not like you have to go to the gym and, you know, and do 60 minutes of cardio, of cardiovascular stuff, but just getting out and walking, any kind of exercise is going to help. And then I know that Dr. Rabin is going to talk a lot more about issues with early menopause, but I just, touching upon it, there's treatment for the vaginal dryness that happens when you have menopause. And there's treatments that are both hormonal and non-hormonal, but there are things that can alleviate that, and that's best to talk to your healthcare provider. And then finally, my piece of the puzzle is when you're struggling with all of these thoughts, is to seek out therapy, to seek out a therapist, to really process what's going on. And CBT, or cognitive behavioral therapy, is really the gold standard for treatment of most psychological difficulties, and that's really been shown to be a great treatment for people who are really struggling with some of the cognitive, with some of the thoughts that they're having, and even some of the sexual difficulties that they're having. And then finally, if these things aren't working, it's probably a good thing to consult with a psychiatrist and look at medications. Because we don't, for whatever reason that we're suffering, we don't have to suffer. We can feel better, and we can feel like ourselves again. And with that, I think Lori's going to come up and talk a little bit about a service or a department that we have at Winthrop that may be of interest. Thank you.
The slide's a little bit skew there, but I just wanted to let you guys know, in addition to the wonderful program that Adelphi has, and that I'm in the community, NYU Winthrop also has a breast health center. There's a dedicated breast nurse navigator, and there's also a dedicated social worker. The nurse navigator helps with all the medical pieces of it, whether that is coordinating treatment, post-op checks, infusion centers, communication with providers, and scheduling. And the social worker helps with support groups, individual therapy, family therapy, community resources, financial, transportation, and insurance troubleshooting. So we don't have the number. I guess you can see them a little bit, but if you called over to NYU Winthrop, they'd be able to connect you. Just wanted to let you guys know that. And then any questions or comments, we're happy to take them.
I think we'll do questions overall at the end.
Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Jill Raven, and I'm always late. I'm a gynecologist, and most of what you've heard this evening is pretty much all you're going to need to know, plus the answers to your questions. So I hope to be able to add a little bit of information. I have one drink of water.
And if you could use the mic, because we are live on Facebook, and so it'll help us to hear a little better.
That is really exciting.
I know.
Is it okay if I stand in a different place, though? I hate to stand behind a podium.
Yes.
And there's the mic. Okay. Is this okay?
Let's okay, see. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Good wake the dead with my voice. Okay. So, let's see. Oh, it worked. Okay. So, a couple goes to the doctor, and the doctor examines the husband and says, Mr. Smith, thank you very much. I'm going to give you the results of your tests in a few minutes. I'm going to examine Mrs. Smith next. Examines Mrs. Smith. They're clearly an older couple. Mrs. Smith gets examined, and the doctor says, Mrs. Smith, you're in incredible shape. How old are you? She says, my next birthday, I'm going to be 88 years young. He says, Mrs. Smith, that's incredible. You look 20, 30 years younger. Tell me, do you and Mr. Smith still have intercourse? So she's thinking, and she opens the door. She's still in the exam gown. Sam, do we still have intercourse? So he says back to her, how many times do I have to tell you it's Blue Cross, Blue Cross? So, you know, in 1850, the life expectancy for women was 43. So I would venture to say that at least half of us in this room would not be here. So the fact is that any day above ground is a good day. And 20 years ago, 21 years ago, my mom was diagnosed with breast cancer. She never complained. She did very, very well, in large part to the strength of the relationship with my dad, who loved her unconditionally, and it was a beautiful relationship. And when she passed away last year of complications from another type of cancer, but when she was diagnosed, their relationship was never stronger, and our bodies are meant to last a certain amount of time, and hopefully in 100 years from now, the life expectancy will be even higher. But the fact is now, a little girl born today can be expected to live to about 92 to 94, which is pretty good. It's a lot of progress in 150, 160 years. And the fact is that our bodies are meant to help us connect with people, to help us connect. But the fact is as we get older and we gain wisdom, our hearts and our minds and our spirits grow in wisdom. Our bodies change. I can tell you, I have a teenage boy. When he was little, he said to me, Mommy, Mrs. Helen taught us in health class today, I think the boobies are supposed to be a little higher, aren't they? So, you know, our bodies change, gravity and so forth. So we use all of ourselves to connect to other people, to fulfill our potential, to help as many people as possible, to have fun in life, to enjoy, to be as positive and as healthy as possible. And when health issues strike, as they will for all of us, we have to rely on the strength that we've already developed in life and our connections with other people and our relationships and the strength of those relationships. And what we look like is not who we are. It's what's inside that really matters. And if a relationship is strong with yourself and whoever you pray to, if you do, if not, not, with your relationships in your life, whatever that strength is for you, you mobilize all of your supports because you've taken care of a lot of people, especially the women in the room, men too. But women, we always take care of our children, our families, our friends, our parents, our aunts, our uncles, the neighbor next door. When you take care of yourself first, then you take care of other people, it's payback time. It's time for everybody to take care of you for a little while until you feel better, and then you can return the favor again. Okay? So it's a matter of connection. So the print on the slides is not that clear, so I apologize. The color didn't come out that well, but I'm basically going to cover in the next 10 minutes or so, 10, 12 minutes, And you've heard a lot about this already, and you guys could probably, you know, teach us. And I want to thank my colleagues, because I learned a lot listening to all three of you. And I heard you, Lori, I heard you from the changing room, because I ran in from work, and I heard you. All the way, we could hear you across the street. You project very well. So I'm going to you know what sexuality is. I'm going to sort of go through this and try to enhance what you've heard already with a couple of pointers. What's sexuality? A screenshot of sex and breast cancer, sexuality after breast cancer, and what you can do. So basically, sexuality, I'm going to stand really close here, because as I've now reached 39, as my Aunt Rose used to say, my eyes are not quite as good as they used to be, especially after a 16-hour workday. Sexuality is the total expression of who we are. It's the way you feel about yourself, and it can include sexual activity, but it doesn't have to. Okay, now you heard a lot about gender, and I learned a lot from listening to you, Carol, and Chris, a lot actually, which I'm going to ask you for a couple of your slides for my next talk. Basically, gender is, as you heard from Dr. Carol, a socially constructed system of classifications that ascribes masculinity and femininity to certain people. And orientation is who you are attracted to, the desire for intimate emotional or sexual relationships with people of the same gender, different genders, or multiple genders, and that's the orientation. And sexuality refers to your exploration of the behaviors, your practices, and your identities, how you identify yourself in the social world. LGBTQ population, basically, they experience, or we experience, the same amount of sexual dysfunction and or function as anybody else. People who have had breast cancer who are LGBTQ experience approximately the same amount of difficulty with decreased sexual desire, difficulty in facing, in reaching orgasm, and more sex-related pain. So in other words, there's no really real difference. The message here is people are people. So there are more than, when I read this, when we were researching this, and I want to thank Kira Lincoln, who's in the audience with her grandmother, her proud grandma. And Kira can come and say a few words if you want. Kira actually wrote an awful lot of this material and researched it, and I appreciate it. But when she wrote that there were over 40 combinations of sexual activity ascribed to most adults, I lost count at 16. So I really actually want to ask her, so what are the other 26? You know. Whatever, math is not the forte. Now, this is a real interesting statistic. About 85% of men report that their partner had an orgasm at the last sexual encounter, and 64% of women say they actually did. We all know this, for the guys in the audience, I mean, really, like, oh, it was wonderful. Look, get me my vibrator, okay. So the sexual frequency goes down with age. I'm not going to read you numbers. Anybody who wants the slides can have them. You can speak to the coordinators of the meeting, Erin and Hillary, and I'm sure we can get you these slides. But frequency goes down with age, basically. So sex and breast cancer, the second part of the three-part triad of my little talk. Most people report that breast cancer will slow down your level of sexual activity and interest. This is no surprise. It's a huge change to your body physically, and it really slows down your energy level overall. It takes longer to get interested in sex. It takes longer for most women, not everybody, it's not one size fits all, to reach an orgasm. And it may become more painful in terms of vaginal dryness and the effect of surgery, chemotherapy, and radiation on your body overall, and your energy level and dryness. Your change in appearance and your body image all have a large effect. I know that. I will tell you that even after surgery, two surgeries, Mom had finally had to have the mastectomy and chemotherapy and radiation. My dad and she still kept the bedroom door closed a couple of times a week because we were younger. And my little sister's much younger, and she used to have a bad habit of walking in, so I would get these reports from my sister Marty, who's deaf, who, like, you know, her voice literally could wake the dead. She's like, you wouldn't believe what they were doing. I said, how the hell do you think you got here? Anyway, you know, any diagnosis, you know, I've had a little I ate something, I was eating out with my dad on Sunday, I got a hold of a piece of chicken that wasn't so great. The last 3-4 days I had a stomach ache. It's getting better. I mentioned it to Caitlin Doyle, our Director of Public Health Initiatives at Northwell Health, who's in the audience. I mentioned it to Caitlin, and I'm thinking, here's a little stomach ache, right? And it's slowing me down a little bit. I had to work a long day, and I'm like schlepping myself along for the whole day. A little stomach ache. So cancer is really a big deal, and it really, and you will know it, it really affects you on a profound physical level, and it takes a long time to deal with the body changes and a long time to get your energy back. And, you know, we are always taking care of other people, so my advice would be take care of yourselves first. Mobilize your supports. Take care of yourself. You've taken care of other people forever. Take your time that you need to take to heal. So, and regroup. Okay, in terms of, you know, the stigma, there is a definite stigma associated, and you have to really love yourself through it, and you have to really allow yourself the time to heal. And the thought for many people, especially the first 3 years after a cancer diagnosis, whether it's breast or other, but in large part cancer, or any gynecologic cancer, the first 3 years is a really important time to heal. And you have to learn how to love yourself, to still love yourself, and to learn how to love yourself in a different way, and to learn how to love yourself more. It's more important now than ever to mobilize those positive feelings, because it also will help your general health. It will also help you heal better and get better faster and move past it and walk through it with your support team. So this is just a study from Boswell and Dyson. 83 breast cancer survivors, all 3 or more years post-diagnosis, were surveyed. And within 3 years, they found that 77% of the women qualified as having sexual dysfunction on the 2 sexual function index scales, which I won't read you the names of. It's not really important, but there are 2 vetted scales. And in other words, this is no surprise. What are you going to do? Have your surgery, have your chemo, have your radiation, go, here I am, honey, I'm fine. Oh, yeah, the cancer, it's fine. You have to go through it, you have to heal, and it's a process. And intellectually, you guys all know this. Emotionally and spiritually, it's another story. You have to put the time in to really heal and love yourself first. So in terms of sexual health and performance, I love that term performance. Oh, I'm performing. Okay, here I am performing. Okay, so there are multiple domains. You all know this. Many of these things, without maybe even knowing the words, you know, there's the desire, the arousal phase, the lubrication, orgasm satisfaction, and God forbid, pain. And your relationship status contributes so much to this. Your overall health, any medical comorbidities, and the frequency of intimacy you were having with your partner, if you have a partner, male, female, undecided, before the diagnosis. It really plays a role in terms of the strength of your relationship. Mind-body connection, I love this. The mind-body connection. How many people have heard the term mind-body connection? The mind is in the body. Who separated them? It's all the same thing. I mean, there's no separation. Mind, body, it's like we're all, you know, we're all one being. We're each our own being. So rediscovering your identity can be difficult, but nonetheless very important. And this is Erica Hart. She is a women's health activist, and this is a picture of her after her reconstruction. You know, your body's changed, lost your hair. I remember all of the wigs mom had. And finally, she said, to heck with it. She wore a scarf, and then she said, to heck with that. And she showed off her bald head proudly. I am a survivor. And she was so positive and so loving once she was able to take the time to heal. She was a force of nature, and she was a force in the community. And those of you who have gone through this, there is an inner strength there, and it's almost as if you're stronger afterwards. I mean, you wouldn't choose to do it. But if you've done it, you've come through it, definitely, probably, you know, stronger and better. Sexuality, I'm going to read this to you. You don't have to squint. This is not an eye test. Sexuality after breast cancer, sexual function. So, you know, you've heard a little bit about that there are treatments available, also that, you know, it takes longer after breast cancer, after a cancer diagnosis, to reach orgasm, to be interested in sex, and everything takes longer when you're older anyway. So you get older through the process, and it's going to take longer. So what can you do in terms of the vaginal dryness? So we're going to talk about dryness, orgasm, and sex response, the fun part of the talk. Okay. Solutions to dryness. Basically, I would like all of my patients in menopause, I tell people that the lubrication that you use is not just for sex. For several reasons. If you just lubricate before you have sex, now I'm talking about any type of sex, with men, with women, with your local fruit store, with vibrators, with anything, that you can't just lubricate right before you put something in the vagina, because the poor little vagina is, or big vagina as it might be, I don't want to make any assumptions, is going to be shocked. It's like, here's some KY, whoa. It has to be able to be prepared. You have to prepare the vagina. You know, like, okay, vagina, I'm going to prepare you. So what you do is you use moisturizers every day. We moisturize our faces, right? Everybody, come on. I know. Even the guys are putting on moisturizer. We all put on moisturizer. Or even if you just use Aquaphor, God forbid that'll clog your pores. But okay. But anyway, you have to moisturize every day. Because as we age, we lose moisture. And then when you have intercourse, whatever's going in there, the vagina is going to stretch more. It's going to increase your elasticity. So your lubricants that you use for intercourse, KY, jelly, there's Astroglide, which is made in Hollywood, California, big surprise. I use Astroglide, yes. Astroglide is an excellent lubricant. It will take you to the moon. It's fantastic. KY makes about 20 different products, KY jelly, Astroglide, there's many, many lubricants for intercourse. And I'm not talking just penis and vagina intercourse, I'm talking about, dilator, I'm talking about vibrator, I'm talking about a nice cucumber, but not an old cucumber because they're like, anyway. So moisturizers, you moisturize every day, there's Replenze, the KY makes a regular moisturizer different than the lubricant. Lubrin, liquid beads, is fantastic. KY liquid beads. Silk and Secret, vaginal silk, S-Y-L-K. It's made from kiwi. It'll smell like a nice fruit. And vitamin E gel caps are all very, very good to moisturize the vagina. So you have to moisturize every day like you moisturize your face. And then you lubricate for intercourse of whatever flavor intercourse. And your topical estrogens, which come in a cream, Premarin or Estrace. Vagifem or Yuvafem is the generic. The generic is just the same in this case as the brand. And that's twice a week, a pill in the vagina twice a week at bedtime, not in the morning so that you're walking around Kmart and the pill falls out. You want it in, while you're lying down. So the pill twice a week in the vagina, the cream 2-3 times a week, and estring or fem ring, which is a ring that stays in the vagina and you change it every 3 months. It looks like a gummy worm, like a little circular gummy worm, and it goes and you don't even feel it. But you can't use any estrogen until you have discussed your individual case with your oncologist or your breast surgeon or your gynecologist, because the truth is, if you did a blood level of estrogen 6 months after taking regular topical vaginal in the vagina estrogen for 6 months, normal estrogen level in menopause is less than 10 picograms per milliliter. If you tried to do an estrogen level in your blood, you probably couldn't find it. It's that low a dose, but you never know. Because estrogens can be associated, as can progesterones, with breast cancer. So you have to really get discussed with your doctor. You tried the moisturizers, you've moisturized every day, you're lubricating, you're like sliding through the aisles at ShopRite. But if you still don't feel well, you gotta talk to your doctor about using an estrogen. And so, the clitoris has at least as many nerve endings, if not more, than the penis. Ha, okay. So, the clitoris is our version of a man's penis, right? And we can hide it better, haha. Okay. The point is, it's good to know where it is. As you get older, especially after chemo or radiation, you may become very sensitive and dry and maybe uncomfortable. So I don't suggest central stimulation over here exactly. I suggest if you are having sexual activity with a penis, a dilator, a vibrator, or a fruit, that you actually stimulate laterally. Laterally, either side, most people have a favorite side in terms of starting to get the arousal mechanism going. Not right in the center because that's going to hurt if it's too much too soon. The traditional sex response cycle, most of you have probably seen this. There's basically desire, arousal, plateau, orgasm, a few orgasms, and reduction. This is the older model. A newer model, which is taken to be a little bit more accurate, and you can enter the circle at any point. In other words, you can emotional intimacy for many people, especially women, really motivates the sexually neutral woman. I don't mean, you know, use like neutral. You're just not really what weren't really planning on, or you know, maybe having a nice dinner in the evening, but you weren't really thinking, okay, we're gonna have an orgasm at about 10:30, all right. But it motivates the intimacy, the hugging, the cuddling, the kissing, to be responsive to the sexual stimuli, the areas, the erogenous zones that you heard about. There are 62 erogenous zones, you said, right? Okay. To be responsive to the erogenous zones, he, she, or undecided gender is, you're in relationship, is stimulating you, you're like, okay, this is cool. And so you get aroused. Psychological and biological factors vary between people, as we're all different, but our differences are what make us similar and connect us, because everybody has differences. So you get aroused, emotional satisfaction, the orgasm, and so forth. And it can be circular and continue all night, or not. And you can enter at any point, okay? So, you know, something arouses you, you know, your whatever that is, and then you go into the cycle without the hugging and kissing. But everybody's different and enters the cycle differently. So these are a variation. There are about 150 different types of vibrators. These are some of them. They come in different sizes. It is a very good idea to learn, especially after breast cancer, after any health issue, a heart attack, a stroke, let your doctor know you're interested in sex again, whatever the medical condition is, make sure it's safe to go ahead and have an orgasm. Usually they will say okay, but you have to ask if there's any question or you're worried. Many people are concerned after a medical comorbidity about when can they have an orgasm and resume sexual activity. So identify for yourself your erogenous zones and what excites you, and you can go ahead and, if you're comfortable, you know, with your own body, which is a good thing to be comfortable with, learn what stimulates you, what interests you, where your zones are. It's okay to do that, and you can use your hands, you can use a vibrator, or fruits or vegetables of your choice, and or your partner can help. And you can also learn how to do Kegel exercises. How many people know how to do a Kegel exercise to tighten their pelvic floor? I'm a urogynecologist. I have wired all of these chairs in advance of tonight's meeting, and I can tell by my little screen over here who is doing a Kegel and who is not, okay? So on the count of three, I want everybody to tighten. One Mississippi, two Mississippi, three Mississippi. You're not doing it. I hear over here. All right, so, and then you relax to a count of three. So tighten to three, relax to three. Over the course of time, that will help your orgasmic potential. It will also help if you have a little bit of stress incontinence, if you leak when you cough, laugh, or sneeze. Even the gotta go, it helps with. So those are the dilators, and they also, this is what dilators look like, actually, and vibrators look very similar, but there are all kinds of different toys. I'm learning all kinds of things. I have a teenager. I'm learning too much. Too much. Partner communication is really so obvious that it's, if you do have a partner, to try and strengthen that relationship, let them support you for a while, and good communication, as Dr. Carroll said, with your trained therapist. There are sex therapists, psychologists, psychiatrists, all of these people are both at Winthrop and at LIJ, Manhasset Northwell Health. We have a breast cancer screening and outreach program, where we also, the cancer services program, where we provide free mammograms and PAP. If anybody knows anyone who's under or uninsured, this is a statewide program. We have this. We also take care of private patients as well, the same as at Winthrop. Both excellent institutions with excellent support. You've heard three of their professionals tonight. I mean, we're so lucky on Long Island to have so many really knowledgeable professionals. So it's okay to get help. It's perfectly okay to get help. And those of you who've accessed help know, what is she talking about? Of course it's okay. But some people are reticent to reach out. So the resources are there, so you'll be only helping yourself, and you deserve to feel good. Everybody deserves to feel as good and be as healthy as possible. It seems like an obvious statement, but as women, we sometimes really want to take better care of other people than we do of ourselves. And the fact is that if we do that, it's like trying to run your car when it's getting empty. And I always say you have to keep your tank at least half full to be able to really take care of other people. Okay, so try to keep an open mind about what constitutes sexual pleasure. You know, There are some types of intercourse which would be distasteful to some people and not to other people. Keep an open mind. You never know. You never know if you haven't tried it. And look on the bright side. I love this one. Kira, thanks for putting this in, honey, but when you get to be my age, you're going to stand up here and give this slide. You're going to go, really? Stand naked in the mirror. Listen to this. Stand naked in the mirror and try to say three positive things about yourself. And I'm thinking, first positive thing, where the hell are my clothes? Second thing, I have to change these lights. They're way too bright.
You just made me do a Kegel next to my grandma, so.
And we're good. We're good. But your grandma did it stronger than you. I got it all right. So I think I've gone way over my time. I apologize. I thank you for inviting me, especially to Erin Naugh and Hillary Rutter for having me here this evening, and to Kira Lincoln for helping me so much with the slides. Caitlin Doyle, as always, and my esteemed colleagues, thanks very much.
Thank you for the presentation. As a patient, should we be embarrassed about saying anything in front of you? Or, you know, how much level of detail should we get into as a patient? Because sometimes if we're not comfortable saying it to ourselves or with our partners, you know, how do we get your attention and how can we feel comfortable saying it to you?
Being a psychiatrist, it's pretty, and I would think it with all healthcare professionals, having that comfort to be able to communicate is really important. And I think that interaction that you have with your healthcare professional should be a safe place where all those things can be discussed. And I think the onus is on us to make it safe. Want you to feel comfortable and encourage you to tell us these details, because in many ways there might be things going on that we can't think or predict. So our hope is that you feel comfortable to discuss these things, and you know, and also and help you troubleshoot to figure out how we can best help you with that. But knowing about making it a safe place is, I think, a critical part. So we do hope that you're able to feel comfortable to communicate about those things.
From what I've seen for a few of the studies that we use to prepare the slides, one of the major deterrents to talking to the healthcare professional is feeling uncomfortable. So I think that while it's really important for the patient to talk to us, we should also be making that part of our comprehensive evaluation at every visit. And it might be good if some of the people that come in, start that conversation with their provider. It could actually be giving a really big service to the next patient that comes in. There's too much of the time, you know, we're 20 minutes in and out, and we're not getting to the important pieces. So I think maybe also the patients can help the providers to set up that expectation.
Yeah, does chemo affect long-term or short-term of the dopamine, norepinephrine, serotonin, and all of those? And how long does it affect, like, you know, how much longer after chemo would that resolve?
You're making reference to some of the neurotransmitters
that
you're talking about?
Yeah, the neurotransmitters, like how chemo affects the neurotransmitters. Does it affect the neurotransmitters, and if so, how long after, or does it like come back?
So neurotransmitters, I'm not quite sure in terms of how, if they would sort of impact them per se. You know, I think that's actually a pretty complex sort of question, to be quite honest. But it's not to say, I can tell you with people who've suffered with breast cancer for long times, depression, anxiety, and these various other mental health conditions that could develop do affect the neurotransmitters. And one we hope with using some of the psychotropic medications that we use is to bring some balance to that. But an actual mechanism to how chemo would affect the neurotransmitter, I'm not so sure that I'm familiar with.
So I don't think chemo crosses the brain.
Right there, right.
Yeah. So I think it's more of that.
So I'm not a medical doctor, but I hang around them. And from what I understand, chemotherapy doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier. So if that would lead me to believe that it's not the chemotherapy that's affecting the neurotransmitters, but it could be a psychological state. It could be depression. It could also be that, you know, we talked about how dopamine is part of the reward circuit, and if you're getting stimulated in various ways, erogenously, but the chemo is making you more sensitive or making it painful, then the reward circuit's not going to be activated.
Yeah, it's more of an indirect process than a direct one, yeah.
Okay.
Good question, though.
I'm just here to talk about the vagina. I know there's a lot of work being done at Feinstein in terms of if you do nerve stimulation, you do get a change in the immune system, you do get a change in cognitive function. Kevin Tracy is doing a lot of work at Feinstein, stimulating the vagus nerve and having a change in various functions. So there is a connection, but Dr. Carol and Dr. Chris are correct. It doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier. That doesn't mean it doesn't have an effect on your mental status and your functioning. And I just want to throw in terms of sharing information with your physician, it's good to write down your questions, because I write down my questions because I forget them also when I go to my doctor. So if you write down your questions and you need to share information, and some of it's personal and in terms of sexuality, and if you're getting brushed off, or they're not taking your question seriously, try to ask it in a different way, especially if you really like your doctor, maybe you have a good relationship. And if you're getting the feeling that you're being sort of marginalized, they're not really listening to you, and it might be extending into other care, it's okay to find another doctor also. There are plenty of doctors practicing in Long Island in the United States, but I would give people a chance, because some of the questions may make certain physicians uncomfortable, and give them a chance to, you know, to establish, you know, you have a physician-patient relationship with them, and you can ask it in different ways and say, look, this is really important to me. You may not know the answer, but if you could look it up and research it for me and get back to me, I'd really appreciate it, because I value my relationship with you. Something like this.
Not really a question, but I don't know if this is even the venue. But a lot of the conversation seems to be around your partner, your partner, your partner. What about us older or single women that don't have a partner and don't have breasts and are ready to go out and date? That's probably a whole different conversation, but I don't have anybody to, I have other people to communicate with, but I don't have a partner and I would like a partner. And where are the conversations about women that had mastectomies, didn't have, or couldn't keep the reconstructed and are living flat and want to go out and date?
So that's a very good topic. So an awful lot of my friends and family fall into this category, and they spend as much time as possible rebalancing their lives for themselves. They will masturbate, they will have the dilator, the lubrication, the moisturizer. In terms of finding a partner at an older age is a separate but related topic. There are people who have had medical comorbidities and people who haven't. As you get older, social circles do shrink. But I will tell you, growing up, I would have done anything to have the type of social network we have with social media. Nowadays, there's a lot more opportunity to meet people now than there was when I was growing up. When I was growing up, we had a princess phone, and if you're lucky, you know, you could see somebody down the block three times a week. you know, I was dating the rabbi's son, and I was like, we were like waving at each other from the window. You know, if I had an iPhone, man, we would have been FaceTiming. I would have had 6 kids. But things are a little bit easier now to reach out. But I do hear what you're saying, and it is isolating. You do have to look for opportunities to meet people, and you do have to put yourself out. If you're comfortable with yourself, which clearly you are, I have no doubt that you're going to be widening your social circle, maybe this evening. You never know. JK.
Other questions?
Does anybody want to ask a bladder question? Those I can really answer without slides.
Don't make us laugh.
No, I've wired all the chairs. I know that. Does everybody know that leaking is not normal? Everybody knows that any kind of incontinence, talk to your doctor and get treatment. Usually surgery is not necessary no matter what they tell you.
So what is treatment?
Treatment, okay. First you get a diagnosis, and if it's stress incontinence, you guys mind if I do this?
No, go ahead.
Okay, I just live in a world of pee-pee. Okay, so stress incontinence is leakage with cough, laugh, or sneeze.
Don't
urgent incontinence, what?
Don't make us laugh.
Well, I mean, how am I going to get business, you know? I was just kidding. So as leakage with cough, laugh, sneeze, urgent incontinence, everybody knows because you turn on the TV and you hear the gotta go. Okay. So that an urgent incontinence is when the bladder contracts without warning the urethra. The urethra may be able to close off just great, but doesn't get a warning, so you leak. That is a nerve problem. Stress incontinence is a muscle problem where the muscles are weak, and with cough, laugh, sneeze, you get a little bit of a leak. And treatments can first get a diagnosis, and you can have both stress and urgent incontinence. And I'm simplifying this for the services of this evening. But basically, you get a diagnosis, and the treatment. There are many treatments. So I will tell you why physical therapy works for both, and that is when you do a Kegel, you strengthen your muscles so that you won't leak it with a cough, laugh, or sneeze. If you do your Kegel exercises, you can make your muscles that hold up your pelvic floor and your urethra as strong as a concrete wall. And then when you cough, laugh, sneeze, you won't leak. So physical therapy works for that, but it also quiets the bladder because there's an integration of your voluntary system that does the Kegel and your involuntary nervous system called the autonomic nervous system. So if you do a Kegel, you voluntarily contract, but it also quiets your involuntary muscles, it quiets the bladder. So physical therapy works for both a nerve and a muscle problem, okay? There's also medications, you guys know that, and there's a lot of other therapies. And then if you have very bad prolapse or very bad leakage, and you've prepared the pelvic floor with physical therapy, strengthening all the muscles, your surgery will last better if you do have surgery, because the muscles comprise 95% of the tissue holding your bladder up in the first place. So if you have a great pelvic floor, your surgery should last. If you go into it with a saggy pelvic floor and they just lift up the urethra, it's gonna basically recur again. And I want to mention one more thing in terms of sexuality and of any sort, with a vibrator, with a cucumber, with a penis, with fingers, with anything. There are a lot of, in regard to Viagra and Cialis, there are a lot of men who are now on medication for ED. And if men have not been used to having an erection for a long time and all of a sudden have this big erection, look, honey, here I am, okay? And a vagina has not had a penis in it for 10, 15, 20 years, what do you think is going to happen to that poor vagina?
I mean,
oh my God. So I tell my patients, I have patients who went into premature menopause, who have surgery and chemo for breast cancer, for uterine cancer, and vaginal and vulvar cancers. You have to moisturize every day and lubricate and gradually use a dilator to stretch the vagina a little bit so that Viagra penis is not going to shock that poor vagina. So you have to build up to it slowly.
Yeah?
Okay?
I love when they tell you after 4 hours, go to the emergency room. I always tell my husband, you're not going anywhere.
That is the best line of the evening.
So, I just wanted to thank everyone for coming out to the forum this evening. Please make sure you fill out the evaluation, and let's give a big round of applause.